Hi, Lonnie Mackley here. I just want to talk to you today a little bit about fetishism, what it is, to help you to understand it, either for yourself or for someone else that you're involved with. Fetishism is something that, first of all, I'm an addictions counselor, so I receive a lot of different requests to understand different types of things. And so you can imagine the emails that I get of people. You know, they'll tell you the truth online anonymously, but they're very ashamed of the different sexual perversion problems that they have, the different fetishes that they end up with. Believe it or not, they don't like them, they don't want them, and they just want to get rid of them, but they just don't know how. So I'll just explain briefly how a fetish starts, and later on how to treat it, if that's what you desire to do. A fetish normally starts very early in someone's life while they're developing psychologically, sexually. And a lot of it has to do with parental issues. Let's just use an example. Say a little boy, perhaps that person is very spiritually sensitive for whatever reason. And so everything affects them. So they're a very sensitive child, very vulnerable kind of child. And perhaps their environment there is very unstable. There's just a lot of things going on. So that child will normally latch on to the affection, the comfort, and the security that they feel with their mother. And but the problem is, in a sense, the mother becomes their first addiction to somebody that is, you know, kind of insufficient as far as certain things that they need emotionally. Their mother becomes their first drug, in a sense. There are other things that can cause a child to become this way, not just spiritually sensitive, but perhaps there's a chemical imbalance. Perhaps the mother did a lot of, had a lot of chemicals in her body that affected the fetus. But either way, the child just feels incomplete. So as they're developing sexually, and if they don't feel that parent is available for them to the extent that they need, perhaps there's an abandonment issue, a death issue, or perhaps the mother just has a lot of other kids where she can't just sit there and hold little Joey for hours on end to comfort him. That child will psychologically begin to look for something else to latch on to. And that could be in the form of any kind of a feminine object that child will latch on to as kind of a fake mother, or it's like a replacement for mom. And it's something that they can hold on to. It's something tangible. They can control. They can grab onto it any time that they want to. But the problem is as they're developing sexually, this object, this feminine object, can become part of their sexual identity, whether they realize it or not. And so whether it's shoes or women's underwear, a part of the female body, whatever it is, that child has got that ingrained in them now sexually. And normally around puberty, they're going to have episodes as children of, you know, running into this fetish problem. And perhaps they're going to steal things like panties or shoes or whatever it is. But it's going to start showing up usually in childhood. And the parents are going to be very disconcerted about what to do about this. And they'll take them to a psychologist or whatever. And the psychologist probably won't know what to do with them. And so the child will get stuck with this, and there's just a lot of shame involved in it. And when the child hits puberty, it seems to just amplify and define that fetish problem, that sexual perversion problem within them, where all of a sudden, they, you know, once they begin to masturbate or engage in sex, they feel that they have to have this object there to get sexually aroused. Because what happened is, the very part of their early part of their life, things split. In other words, their sense of femininity split between a real living person and an object. So they need to have both in order to experience sexual gratification. And since it is an addiction, since it is an obsession, evil spirits can play into this and try to, and a lot of it can be like power issues. A fetish deals a lot with feeling a sense of power, control, and sometimes punishment and revenge toward a parent and through an object. And it's a consumable form of whatever you feel that you needed or didn't get from a certain parent. And So there's just a lot of issues involved with a fetish where somebody has to have it present if they're going to experience sex. But these spirits can cause somebody to become absolutely obsessed with it, where the sense of power that they feel over, say, femininity or whatever it is, is like a drug to them, and it's thrilling to them. So they'll go out and they'll steal shoes, they'll steal women's underwear, they'll steal all kinds of things for the sense of power that they feel over femininity, over masculinity, if you're a girl or whatever, or maybe you're a guy, it's either way. But there's something that was missing, something that didn't develop as normally as other people, and so you're kind of stuck in a lie concerning sexuality in an area. And that lie stays with you through the rest of your life unless it's resolved to some degree. And it can be very, very difficult to live with something like this. And the only way that you can begin to overcome it, and I just want to say too, if you're a spouse of somebody with a fetish problem, you don't have to just, feel like, you're married to this weirdo that, is this pervert person that you really didn't know existed. And first of all, I want to tell you, if you're the spouse of somebody with a fetish problem, you're not obligated in any way to engage in sexual perversion just because somebody else has a problem with it. If you're not comfortable with it, you don't have to do it, and it's better to get it out in the open right off the bat than to let it become a problem. Because for a spouse, if the other spouse introduces a fetish or sexual perversion, that spouse is going to feel like the other person, really is wanting or enjoying the fetish in place of them. In a sense, they are, though. And so it can become a real issue, and some people just kind of go along with it, realize it's just something. They realize that, maybe there's something went wrong with their parents when they're young, or whatever it is, they kind of go along with it. But the goal should be to become sexually normal or sexually healthy so that you can have a healthy sexual relationship. Now, I want to just say with a fetish, it's an established preference, just the same as, preferences that you may have, like with eating. Supposing you like pizza. Fetish is just a sexual preference, so telling yourself that you don't like it anymore or you don't want it anymore is like telling yourself you don't like or want pizza anymore. It just doesn't work. So what you have to do is you have to get back to the roots of where the lie started, and you have to replace that lie with truth. And with fetishes, supposing you have a woman's underwear fetish. Okay, other people, I'm speaking to the fetishist here, they don't see that as a form of sexuality or a replacement of mother, sexual idol. They just see it as a piece of clothing. And there are items of clothing or body parts that you see that you don't feel sexually aroused by. Say, let's just say a hat, woman's hat. You probably just see that as a hat. Well, that's how they see it. And we've got to get you back to the place of seeing your fetish as just a normal object. So what you do is you go to God and you just give him your problem, whatever your fetish is. I know you'll be a little embarrassed, a little ashamed of it, but God created you. He knows how you tick, and he knows how to fix you if you break. And so you just give that to him, and what the Holy Spirit will begin to do is to bring you from a place of abnormality to a place of normality, a place of error to a place of truth concerning that object or that body part of that or that act. And in time, you will be able to see your fetish just as normally as you see something that is not a fetish. But it takes time, it takes commitment. For some people, you may have to actually abstain from sex if it becomes too much of a distraction or hindrance to you in your sexual relationship. You also have to think of your eternal salvation. People that practice sexual perversion here do not inherit the kingdom of God, which just means that you don't make it to heaven when you go. So it's something important that you need to deal with here. And it's something that shouldn't be ignored. So I want to invite you to, if you need more help, there's a group called Spirit-Led Recovery from Addiction. Type in Lonnie Mackley to Yahoo and you'll find it. But I just want to encourage you that there is hope, that if you have a fetish problem, believe it or not, God, or sexual perversion problem, God can take you from what is error to what is truth. But you have to give this problem to him, and you have to commit yourself to working with him every day. Okay? I hope this helped you. Bye-bye.